हेलो सर,
हाय, सो वील कंटिन्यू डिस्कसिंग दिस गैसियस स्टेट,
या
बट टुडे वी विल फोकस अ लिटिल मोर ऑन अ लिटिल मोर डिटेल्स एंड वील लुक एट एटकिन्स.
ओके
एवरीवन हैज द एटकिन्स पीडीएफ, नो?
या
ओके, सो दिस इज इन द बुक. इट इज चैप्टर वन एंड इट इज डिवाइडेड इनटू थ्री पार्ट्स, 1A, 1B and 1C. If you open the text in PDF for Atkins, that is
या
how
yeah, हम
shortened
ओपनिंग
is.
इट या
Yeah.
जस्ट अ सेकंड. सो आई विल जस्ट गो टू द कंटेंट्स वंस. या आई सी मैटर फर्स्ट. या
हाँ, so 1A
ए
is the
वन ए टू
perfect
ए थ्री.
gas. 1A is called, chapter is called the perfect gas. So basically, you are talking about the ideal gas here.
One, yeah, it was a perfect guess. Got it.
Dev, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Okay. So we have already discussed this. So it starts off with different variables of state, and we have discussed that state variables are variables like PVTN, which describe the system completely, right? And if there is a relationship between these variables, suppose P is equal to function of VTN, right? Some unknown function, then this equation, which is relating these variables, is called an equation of state. Equation of state for the gas, right? Now, such a relationship would mean that if we know three of the state variables, if we know three variables, we can find out the fourth. Correct? Right.
Yeah.
So that is the meaning of an equation of state, and that is a state variable. Now, we'll go over things that we have already discussed. We'll go over that quickly. So this is pressure and all. We already know what it is. Standard pressure. See, there is a table which has units of pressure. So all the conversions are there. 1 bar is 10^5 Pascal. One atm is 101325 Pascal. So one atm is basically almost equal to 1 bar, and Pascal is 1 newton per meter square, and one torr. So just this is just so for information's sake, so that you don't mess up stuff if there is a different unit that is given. One torr basically means 1 mm of Hg. So it is 1/760 into atm, right? So one torr is basically the height of a 1 mm Hg column and the weight of that column, right? Mg by area. We have derived how pressure is measured using the pressure is equal to rho gh, right? Rho is the density of the liquid. And h is the height of the liquid column. Everyone is aware of this, no, and understands what this by this is, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
You measure pressure in this way. Now, going down. Okay. So then there are some relationships. Empirical basis, the Boyle's law, Charles' law, Avogadro's principle, we already know all of that. Equations of state is a general equation which connects the four variables. We just now discussed it. Now, there are some figures, PV graph. Notice that it's a hyperbolic graph, PV graph. Figure 1.8.2, I think. 1.8.2. If you see the PV graph for Boyle's law, he has drawn multiple hyperbolas, right?
Yeah.
This is pressure, this is volume. Correct. And as you go away from the origin, the temperature increases. So what it means is this hyperbola, this curve is PV is equal to constant, and the value of the constant depends on the temperature. Depends on temperature. And basically, if the temperature here is T1 and temperature here is T2 on this curve, and temperature here is T3, we know that T3 is greater than T2, is greater than T1. So it's a plot like this, xy is equal to c square. If c is bigger, the hyperbola is farther away from the origin. Okay.
Correct. So, yeah.
Because in the gas law equation, we have PV is equal to nRT, no? So if nRT, if T is constant on the whole this is called an isotherm. Why is it called an isotherm? Because temperature is constant on this whole line. Isotherm. On this isotherm, P and V values can change, but temperature is constant. And if you switch over to a different isotherm, temperature is again constant, but it is a higher value. Right?
Right.
Correct.
And as you go away, it is higher because it is directly proportional to temperature. Right? So that is that figure. After that, if you go down, then there are other figures also. If you plot P versus 1 by V, right? P and 1 by V. So then you will get slope of the graph. So P is equal to nRT into 1 by V, right? So from the same equation, this is my Y and this is my X. So Y is equal to MX, right? This is a straight line through the origin.
Correct.
So if you make a graph of P this side and 1 by V on this side, then it should be straight lines passing through the origin, right? And slope of the line is directly proportional to T. So higher slope means higher temperature. So this way temperature increases, right?
Yeah.
So these are different representations of the same thing. Okay, so we'll move on. Okay. So the gas constant R can be determined. So gas constant R can be determined by the value of R is equal to PV by NT. At any temperature, you can find pressure, volume, and temperature, number of moles and T. And that will give you the value of the gas constant R, right? Now, this gas constant is connected to the Boltzmann constant, K into Avogadro number. So remember, K came in the discussion of entropy, right? S is equal to K ln W we had written, right?
Yeah.
So when we are doing entropy discussions, we are saying that entropy of a system is K into ln W, where W is the number of ways in which you can have that system exist, right? Number of possible ways in which the system can exist, right? So this K was the Boltzmann constant, whose value was 1.38 into 10 to the power minus 23, 10 to the power minus 23 joule per Kelvin. I'm not sure about the unit, wait one second. Q is equal to TdS, so Q by T is equal to a unit of entropy. So joule per Kelvin is unit of entropy. So this is joule per Kelvin, this one, Boltzmann constant. Okay. And the same Boltzmann constant turns up here. So this is a connection that you should know. So and joule per Kelvin mole. So Na is Avogadro. Na is what? K. Na is 6.02 into 10 to the power 23 per mole. No.
Yeah.
This is the meaning of this Na. Avogadro number means this many quantities per mole, right? So
yes,
R will be equal to 1.38 into 10 to the power minus 23 joule per Kelvin multiplied by 6.02 into 10 to the power 23 per mole, right? Which gives nicely, it comes that it becomes 8.314 joule per Kelvin mole. This is the value of the gas constant.
Right.
Okay. So you have to know that gas constant and Boltzmann constant are related by this Avogadro number relationship. Okay. Okay. So this is fine. Then we go down. Okay. All this we have already discussed. Now standard temperature and pressure, you know what it is, right? 273 Kelvin and 180 m pressure.
Yeah.
Is another unit that is now used. The other unit that is now used is sometimes called standard ambient temperature and pressure, SATP, which is a normal room temperature. So it is 298 Kelvin and 180 m pressure.
Is it like NTP? Or is it different from that?
It's like that only. I don't know what NTP is. NTP is not
normal temperature and pressure.
So it
okay, is fine.
Same name.
Yeah, I think it's this. Yeah.
Standard temperature and pressure, STP, is at 273.
Yeah. Yeah, understood. Yeah.
And this is defined as SATP. But it's not so important. I mean, this is just information. Mixtures of gases, then we come down to mixtures of gases and Dalton's law. We have already discussed this partial pressure and mixtures of gases. So, okay. So this 1A is done. 1A is this much only. Are there any questions here? No. There are no questions. At the end of the whole chapter, there are questions, I think.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so 1A is this. 1B is kinetic theory of gases. Kinetic theory of gases. So, okay. So 1B, he proceeds by first telling you that kinetic model is based on just three assumptions. Just three assumptions. Some books make it into five, but here he is saying only just three assumptions. The first assumption is gas consists of molecules of mass m in ceaseless random motion obeying the laws of classical mechanics. So gas contains molecules of mass m moving around randomly. Moving randomly according to the laws of mechanics. Laws of mechanics. Then the second one, the second assumption states that size of the molecules is negligible in the sense that diameters are much smaller than the average distance that they travel during the collision. So molecular size is much smaller than the distance that it travels during a collision. Okay, so it is saying that this D is greater than the radius. Okay, so size of the molecules is negligible. That is the second assumption.
Right.
And the third is that collisions, the molecules interact with each other through collisions which are elastic. Collisions happen and collisions are assumed to be elastic collisions. Correct?
Yeah, we discussed this point.
So these three assumptions will help you build up a entire theory for gases, which will explain everything. And it can actually help you derive the PV is equal to NRT also. So how do we get there? So here he has mentioned in justification, there is a justification 1.1b, right? That justification gets you to this 1B1 equation. Equation 1B.1 is PV is equal to 1 by 3 MNV square, where V square is RMS velocity. So we'll discuss what that means. This is the.
So where's that expression again?
Huh?
The PV is equal to what expression? Where is it? Like I only see the collision part.
1B1. This is just below that.
Oh, okay, fine. Yeah, I see it now.
So we'll discuss what the justification is. Now here, 1/3 mn, this is, wait one second, I made a mistake. 1/3 nm v square RMS, right? N is the number of molecules, I think. N is the total number of molecules and capital M is the molar mass. N is total number of molecules and capital M is molar mass of the gas. Of the gas. Now, or molecular mass of the gas. So, it is molar mass actually. So, below that he has written capital M basically is equal to mass of one molecule into Avogadro number. Small m will be mass of one molecule, okay? Because see, this was one of the assumptions, no? Molecules of mass small m, right?
Yeah.
So
correct.
Capital M will be small m into Avogadro number of molecules. That will be molar mass, no? Gram per mole.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is capital M, and N is the total number of molecules. N is the total number of molecules. V square RMS we'll discuss soon. And PV is normal stuff. So how do we get there? Let's look at this justification. So justification 1.1b. Okay. How do we come up to this equation? So 1.1b here, what we are doing is see the figure 1b1. So random molecules are moving around, right? They're moving around in this box. Okay. Now, when a particle of mass m that is traveling with a component of velocity parallel to the x-axis collides with the wall on the right and is reflected, its momentum changes from mvx to minus mvx, right? Correct? We had seen that earlier. Like if a particle comes with mvx, its momentum will now change to minus mvx. So the change in momentum is basically 2 mvx. Magnitude of change in momentum is 2 mvx, right?
Correct. Right.
Correct. So on each collision, the x component of momentum therefore changes by 2 mvx, right? And the y and z components are unchanged.
Yes.
On each collision, x component of momentum, delta px, is equal to 2 mvx, while delta py is equal to delta pz is equal to 0. This is what is happening here. Then, many molecules collide with the wall in a time interval delta t, and the total change in momentum is the product of the change in momentum of each molecule multiplied by the number of molecules that collide, right? That reach the wall during that interval. So let's say we are talking about a delta t time interval. So total change in momentum would be equal to 2 mvx is the change in momentum in each collision multiplied by the number of molecules like this that hit the wall in that time interval, right? Number of molecules that reach the wall in delta t time. Correct?
Correct. Yeah.
So now in delta t time. So now what happens here is that because a molecule is moving with vx velocity, it can travel a distance vx delta t along the x-axis in an interval delta t, right? So all the molecules within a distance of Vx delta t will strike it, right?
Like, correct.
Like suppose one started from here, some started from here, some started from here, right? And this is the distance Vx into delta t, right? Right? All the molecules in this region, if they are moving towards this, they will strike right. the wall, right?
Right.
So a total volume of Vx delta t, Vx delta t is the total volume in which all the molecules will strike the wall, right? Vx delta t into area, obviously. Right?
Yeah.
That is the volume, no, in which molecules will strike the wall. Correct?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So A into Vx delta t, how many particles are there in that, right? So the number density of particles is N into Na by V. So now N into Na by V. Okay, so N was number of moles, right?
Right.
And suppose Avogadro number of particles are there per mole. So total number of particles is N into Na, right?
Right.
And what is the particle density? That is by divided by total volume box. This is the density of particles per unit volume, right? Correct? Yeah. So if you multiply this density of particles by per unit volume, multiply it by the area Vx, multiply it by the volume Vx delta T into area, right? You should get the number of particles in this volume, right?
Yes.
And each of them will experience a momentum change of 2mvx, right? Correct.
Yeah.
And V is basically equal to A into the total length, right? So he has just written that 2mvx by, okay. The number of, so he is multiplying, number of molecules in the volume is NNA by V into AVx delta T, right? Which is what we have written. NNA by V into AVx delta T, right? Correct. Now what he's saying is, at any given moment, half the particles will be moving towards this and half will be moving towards this. Like on average, it will not be like all particles are moving this side, no? Right? On average, you can say, because there are so many infinite number of particles, half of them will be moving towards the left and half will be moving towards the right, right? So you have to divide by two here to say the total momentum change that will happen due to this wall, right? This many particles are not there, half of them, right? So when you divide by two, this two cancels and you end up getting M into N, Na by V, A, Vx square delta T. So M into N, Na by V, A, Vx square delta T, right? Total momentum change. Correct?
Yeah.
What is the meaning of this M into Na by V? N into Na was total number of particles. I multiplied by small m mass of each particle, right? That is the total mass of the gas, no?
Correct. Right.
That is the capital M, no?
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Right, capital M was total mass or molar mass?
Molar mass. It was molar mass. Capital M was molar mass.
So N moles of gas into Avogadro number means total number of molecules into small m, mass of each molecule. I think it is total mass, no, now.
But now it's total mass, but capital M was molar mass.
Where was it molar mass?
That's what we discussed, right?
When we discussed strong, no, this makes, what does it mean?
Then I don't know them. Like you told, we discussed that it's going to, capital M is the molar mass.
Right now, what does it mean here? Small m into?
Right now, I think it's right now what we want is the total mass. We discuss that n into n is total molar mass, right? So yeah, this thing is capital M. So
small m is mass of one molecule. Small m is mass of one
number
molecule.
And this into is number of molecules.
Number of molecules. So total mass. This is total mass. Okay. So m by v is density. Mass by volume is density. This portion is all becoming density, rho. So
yeah.
Delta P is becoming M by V into M by V multiplied by A Vx square delta T. A Vx square delta T. And here what we are calling M is total mass is equal to small m into N into Na. Right? And
yeah.
N into Na is the M into Na is molar mass, not N into Na.
Okay.
Like if you.
Yeah, it should be M into Na.
M into Na is molar mass.
Yeah.
Molar mass. And so you can say that capital M total mass is equal to N times molar mass, which makes sense.
Right? Yeah.
So basically, you can also write this in terms of molar mass. So it is N times molar mass A Vx square delta T by V. Right?
Mm.
This is the total change in pressure, total change in momentum. So
right.
Now, A into delta T. Okay, so we have to think of that. Okay, so divide by delta T to get force. Delta PT P by delta T is equal to average force.
Yeah.
Is equal to N M A V X square by V, and divide by area to get pressure. Pressure is equal to N M V X square by V, right? Force by area is pressure, no?
Correct.
So you're getting pressure is equal to N M by V V X square, right? Now this equation, now we have to understand what is the meaning of this V X square and V Y square and V Z square. So at any moment, the velocity of a particle is V X I cap plus V Y J cap plus V Z K cap, right?
Yeah.
Speed is equal to Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square root over, right?
Correct.
So speed square is equal to Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square, right?
Yeah.
And no particle, the particle doesn't have a favorable direction. It's not like mode of the particles favor going in the X or Y or Z, right? So if you take speeds of all the particle, right? If you take speeds of all the particles, this V square will become equal to 3 Vx square. Because Vx square will be equal to Vy square is equal to Vz square.
How can you repeat this point again?
So if you think of V RMS, this is RMS speed of a particle. RMS speed of a particle means root mean square speed. Root mean square. So what is the meaning of that. That means basically take each of the square speed. First of all, you have to do square speed. So let's say we have five particles, V1, V2, V3, V4, V5 are the speeds, right? These are the speeds of five particles. So first you have to do square of the speed. So we take the numbers V1 square, V4 square, V5 square, right?
Yeah.
Then to get mean square speed, we take the average of the square speeds. So that means for five particles, it should be V1 square plus V2 square plus V3 square plus V4 square plus V5 square by 5. This is called mean square speed. Basically, it is summation of V square by N, total number of particles. Right? Now you take root of the mean square speed. Root of the mean square speed will become root over, in this question, it will become V1 square plus V2 square till V5 square by 5. Or general formula is root over summation of V square by N. So that is the meaning of VRMS. So VRMS whole square will be summation of V square by N. Basically, this is mean square speed. The root you are not removing, right?
Yeah.
Mean of the square speeds, right?
Yeah.
So now what we are saying is that since we are taking average of the speeds of all the particles, not just the speed, square of the speed, right? So you have to add up all the V square for all the molecules, right? So V1 X square plus V1 Y square plus V1 Z square plus V2 X square plus V2 Y square plus V2 Z square.
Correct.
And so on, right? You will have to add the square of the speed for each particle, right? And there are billions and billions of particles, Avogadro number, right? So what will happen is that it's unlikely that any one particular direction is going to be favored, no? Like when you do the average here, right? You can properly say that Vx square will be same as Vy square, will be same as Vz square.
Right.
Because it's not likely that most of the particles are moving in Z direction or something. No direction is favored. Everything is going to be on average same, right? So when you do this, you can say that instead of Vx square that came in my earlier equation, I can write it as 1 by 3 of V square. Because Vx square plus Vy square plus Z square is equal to same. And that is total sum is equal to V square, right?
Yeah.
Correct? So earlier the equation was P is equal to Nm Vx square by V. P is equal to Nm Vx square by V. This was my earlier equation. Now, what you will do is, he's saying, see, not all molecules travel with the same velocity. So the detected pressure is the average of the quantity just calculated, right? So if you take, this is pressure due to one particle. So detected pressure is going to be the average of this quantity. So Nm, average of this Vx square by V. So this cross symbol, this symbol denotes average of whatever is inside.
Yeah.
Right. So now we know that we have decided that all directions are identical. So this should be equal to Vy square, should be equal to Vz square. And we know that Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square is equal to V square. Right. So here we can replace it by 1 by 3 m n m v square by v. Right.
Yeah.
Correct.
Now this is my v square of RMS. This is my RMS velocity squared. This is called RMS velocity squared. So you get p pressure that is detected into V is equal to 1 by 3 n m V square RMS. This is the main equation. Okay. So he's saying to write an expression of the pressure in terms of the mean square speed, we begin by writing the speed of a single molecule V square is equal to Vx square plus Uy square plus Vz square. Because the root mean square speed is defined as root of this, it follows that that is equal to root of this average. So because all particles are moving randomly, all three averages are same. So V square RMS is equal to 3 times Vx square. So Vx square is 1 by 3 V square RMS, and then you get that equation. Now, what he is saying is equation 1B1. This 1B1 is one of the key results of a kinetic model. We see that the pressure, So this is one of the key results of this kinetic model. And he is saying that if V square RMS depends only on temperature, right? Then what we'll have is PV will be equal to some constant, right? We'll have Boyle's law because these numbers will be fixed.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. So, and if temperature is constant, and if temperature is also constant, right? So this will become PV is equal to NRT if we convert this in some way. So we have to find the connection between V square RMS and temperature. So so that connection again comes from kinetic theory only. The connection is that V square RMS is equal to 3RT by M. Now that means VRMS is equal to root of 3RT by M. How does this thing come? It comes because you are saying that each particle has a velocity V, which is Vxi plus Vyj plus Vzk, right? Now, there is three directions in which it can move, no? It can move in three different directions, right? So this is called something called equipartition theorem or basically, how many degrees of freedom does a molecule have? How many degrees of freedom? Degrees of freedom means in how many ways can a molecule move? Does a molecule have? So if you are thinking of your molecule as a single isolated particle, right? In how many ways can it be moving around, right? It can basically move in X, it can move in Y, it can move in Z, right? So it is said to have 3 degrees of freedom. If it is a monoatomic molecule has 3 degrees of freedom. And Boltzmann's equipartition theorem says that each degree of freedom corresponds to the energy half k into t. In each degree of freedom, there is half kt energy. So 3 degrees of freedom, the total energy of the particle will be 3 into half kt. So 3/2 kt is the energy of a particle if it has 3 degrees of freedom. Now, we will say, take examples. For example, this is one particle, single molecule, monoatomic molecule, okay? Monoatomic particle, there's no meaning to a molecule here. As opposed to this, let's take a diatomic molecule, right? Diatomic molecule.
Yeah.
So Here it has ability to move around in three directions, x, y, z, right? So degrees of freedom is equal to 3, and by equipartition theorem, kinetic the total energy of the particle, internal energy, will be 3 into half kt. K is the Boltzmann constant, T is the temperature. Now think of what is possible for a diatomic molecule. Right? Now diatomic molecule has an ability to rotate also, no?
Yeah.
Has an ability to rotate. Okay, correct. So its center of mass can move in three ways, right?
Yes, it can.
Its center of mass can move in three ways. So 3 degrees of freedom are already there, but it can also rotate like this, right? And it could also rotate like this, but that doesn't count.
Okay.
Like, think about it. If there is a two balls,
it's right? The same thing.
Two balls like this. If it is rotating in this way around this axis, like rotating like this, and this is the axis, Z axis, right? Then there is moment of inertia, right? About this.
Yes, there is.
This is M, this is M, this is R, right? So moment of inertia of this will be MR square plus MR square.
Yeah.
Total moment of inertia will be 2MR square, right?
Correct.
So there is some moment of inertia about this axis. So kinetic energy we will do in rotation is half I omega square, because we are replacing the same half mv square in terms of rotational constant. M takes the place of I takes the place of M, and velocity, instead of velocity, we have angular velocity, right?
Correct.
So this we will do in our rotation class soon. So half I omega square is kinetic energy. So in this case, I is not zero, right? So there is kinetic energy in this frame, no? Like this.
Yeah.
Yes.
Rotation is possible and kinetic energy is there in rotation. So plus 1 degree of freedom due to rotation like this.
Yeah.
1 degree of freedom comes because it could also rotate while moving ahead, right? And it could also rotate like this along this axis. It could also rotate like this. No?
Correct.
Right? Because there also there is moment of inertia of 2mr square, right?
Yeah.
Correct.
We don't know where it will, how it will rotate, but it is free to rotate in these two axes, right?
Mm.
So there is plus 1 degree of freedom due to this rotation. But what rotation is not useful is rotation about this axis, because kinetic theory is assuming that the particle are really small, no? So what is the moment of inertia? It's almost like a point. So moment of inertia about this line is zero, no?
Yes, it is.
So suppose you have a line like this, and there is one point here, one point here, and then it is a unidimensional point. So there is nothing, no rotation possible. No? It has to have some extended nature to have some moment of inertia, right?
Yeah.
You are assuming in kinetic theory that the balls are really small, the gas molecules are really small, right? So if it was a sphere, it would have a moment of inertia, or a plate, it would have a moment of inertia, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
But it is a point particle. So zero moment of inertia around this axis, Ix axis. There is moment of inertia about Iy and Iz, right? But nothing around Ix, right?
Correct. Yeah.
So there is no kinetic energy possible in this type of a rotation. Actually, if it was an extended body, then all three kinetic energies were possible, right? Rotation.
Yeah.
Right? Here, only 2 degrees of freedom due to rotation, not 3.
Mm-hmm.
Due to rotation. So for a diatomic molecule, what you will find is that there are 5 degrees of freedom. 5 ways in which the molecule can exist and have energy, right? So Now what happens because of that is that it becomes 5 into half kT is the energy.
Yeah.
5 by 2 kT is the energy in that case. Now things can be even more complicated if there are polyatomic molecules and all, right? It will be much more complicated. So this is equipartition theorem. This is also something that right now you just have to believe it. You cannot prove it right now. The proof is in advanced courses. It cannot be done. The fact that half kT for each, you know, each degree of freedom comes, right? So what happens as a result of this is that if you have a single monoatomic type of particle, then you have 3 by 2 kT of energy due to this particle, because 3 degrees of freedom are there, right? Now this energy will show up as a kinetic energy, right?
Correct.
This energy will show up as a kinetic energy. If you think of it as a point particle, you have this equation. And this equation means that V square RMS is equal to 3KT by small m, right? Now, 3KT by small m. Small m was mass of one molecule. Mass of one molecule. And K was Boltzmann constant, right?
Correct.
Now, if I do something like 3K and multiply on top by Avogadro number and on the bottom by Avogadro number, right?
Correct. Yeah.
Then K into Na becomes gas constant.
Yeah.
And bottom becomes molar mass. Okay. So this is the formula. This is how the VRMS is equal to root 3RT by M comes. What is happening is basically you are doing equipartition theorem from Boltzmann, which is saying that each degree of freedom has half kT energy. Half kT energy in every degree of freedom. In every degree of freedom. And if it is a monoatomic gas with part like helium or something, right? So then if helium is moving around, then it can move around in 3 degrees of freedom. So this 3 by 2 kT energy will come as its kinetic energy. And you will get V square RMS is 3 kT by M. And if you multiply it by Avogadro number, you will get the formula that comes. 3 R by molar mass. So V RMS comes as 3 RT by M. Now our equation that we had earlier, which was PV is equal to 1 by 3 N M V square RMS, right? This was the equation. And now 1 by 3 NM into 3 RT by M for V square RMS. So this cancels and 3 cancels and it becomes PV is equal to NRT. You could also write this equation in a slightly different way. PV is equal to 1 by 3 NM V square RMS, and instead of that you could write 1 by 3 NM, you could have written 3 KT by small m, right? Small m, no?
Yeah.
So, correct? And 3 cancels, and this becomes N was number of moles, right? And small m, capital M by small m, right? Is Avogadro number, no?
Correct.
N into R, right? Capital M by small m is Avogadro number, no? Right? Because capital M is molar mass and small m is mass of one molecule. So that will be one mole, no?
Correct.
That will be Avogadro number, and you'll get N into Na into KT, and that is the same as NRT. Right?
Yeah.
So, That's the same derivation. It's, so I hope everybody is understanding what this RMS is. V square RMS is. V square RMS is the average of the square of the speeds. And okay. And then take root. V RMS is equal to average of root of average of the squares. Okay. Yeah. And V RMS is equal to root over 3KT by small m is equal to root over 3RT by capital M. And this is the equation that comes from kinetic theory, from the normal derivation. And from there, now using this result, you can prove that PV is equal to NRT. Correct?
Right, so, right.
So, this is what he has done here. Bolt Maxwell, then the second next section is Maxwell Boltzmann distribution of speeds. This part, I don't think it is necessary. This is not there in the syllabus, but you just need to know some possible speeds. So some possible speeds that are there. So there are some formulas for speeds of the particles in a gas which come. So we will just discuss one or two of them. You will have to go down. So I will explain it a little briefly. What is this Maxwell Boltzmann distribution of speeds? Maxwell Boltzmann speed distribution. Speed distribution means what are the speeds of the gas molecules? What are the speeds of the gas molecules? That is the question. So now what it means is there is a curve which has some peak somewhere, and this curve is showing you the number of particles. This is velocity, this is V, and this is V plus dV, and this is dN by distribution function. One second. Okay. The number of particles is here. Number of particles. So what it means basically is that if you take a section like this, this section, so this is a tiny width, right? V to V plus dV. What does it mean? It means the speed was V and now the speed is V plus dV. So how many particles in the gas have the speed between V and V plus dV? What does that mean? You're basically trying to count. Suppose there are 1,000 particles, right? 1,000 particles. You are saying, how many particles have speed between 45 meter per second to 45.1 meter per second, right?
Yeah.
So this number will be plotted on the y-axis. And this is the speed distribution. You understand? So any place, suppose between 45 to 45.1, there were 10 particles, right? So 10 will be here. So this is the typical Maxwell-Boltzmann speed distribution where there is a particular speed, right, which has the highest number of particles. V has highest number of particles, right?
Correct.
That speed is called V most probable speed. Makes sense, no? Like this speed has most number of particles. So it is the most probable speed. Right?
The whole understanding is that actually gas molecules can have speeds in from zero to infinity. In any sample of gas, you will find a particle with a very wide ranging distribution of speeds. You will find different particles having very different speeds. Okay. It could be that one particle is having speed of 1 meter per second, and another one, there is one particle here which is 1013 meter per second. Because the number of particles is almost infinite in any situation. It is Avogadro's number is uncountably large, like super huge, right? So
correct.
The speeds don't have to follow any rule. There is no limit. It could be really high for a few particles. It is like this. This is the distribution. As you go to higher speeds, you find lesser number of particles. Lower speeds also, you find lesser number of particles. There is one particular speed which has maximum number of particles, right?
Yeah.
That speed is called most probable speed. Okay. There is a maxima of this distribution function at most probable speed, right? So if someone, so Maxwell Boltzmann figured out this function, what is the curve and what is the equation for this? Okay. So if you can find the maxima of this, you will get the most probable speed. Okay. You can also find average speed. What is the average speed of all the particles, right? Now, most probable speed is not going to be equal to the average speed, okay? Because average can be distorted by these values, right?
Yeah.
You understand? If the values are very high, some of them can distort the average and shift it towards this side, right?
Yeah.
Correct? So average speed and most probable speed are not the same. So what we have, results that we have, is V most probable speed is equal to root over 2RT by M. Okay. V average speed is equal to root over 8RT by pi M. And V RMS we have already seen is root over 3RT by M. So we have the sequence VMP is less than equal to VRMS, and that will be less than equal to, wait, RMS is highest. So this is average, I think, and less than equal to VRMS. See, 8 by pi is 2 point something, right? And this is 2.
Yeah.
So this is root over 2 into RT by M, and is less than root over 2 point something into RT by M. And this is less than root over 3 into RT by M, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So notice that if your distribution function was given to you, some function, then you could take df by dv is equal to 0 and find the maxima, right?
Yeah.
Right. Find the maximum. So distribution function will be a function of D. And this is called N. The numbers will be given. So N of V. So 1 second. Distribution function looks like, if you look at the textbook, it looks like F of V. Okay, F of V only. It depends on velocity also. The 1B4 is the complicated expression, right? So for example, okay, let's just do it once. F of V is equal to, what is it coming? See, F of V is equal to 4 pi into some constant to the power 3 by 2, right? 4 pi into m by 2 pi RT to the power 3 by 2. M by 2 pi RT to the power 3 by 2 multiplied by V square into e power minus m by 2 m V square by 2 RT. M V square by 2 RT, right?
Yeah.
This is the thing. Now, if I want to find velocity at which f of v is maximum, right? This f of v was showing me the numbers, right?
Yeah.
F of v was showing me the height. How many are there in this particular range? V to v plus dv, right? So if you try to find maxima of f of v, so I will with respect to velocity, at what velocity does that happen? So your y is f of v, your x is v, right? V is here and y is f of v, right? So you have to do df by dv here, no? Then should be zero. So this part is a constant, so it doesn't bother. 2 pi rt to the power 3 by 2. I have to differentiate this part, right?
Yeah.
So this will be 2v into e power minus v square m by 2rt plus v square into, now I have to differentiate this. So that will be equal to e power minus mv square by 2rt. And I have to differentiate this part.
Yes.
Right? So that will be minus 2m by 2rt into v, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So this should be equal to zero for maxima or minima, right? So e power this I will cancel, right? Because that is never zero, right? Correct. And you get 2v minus v square, and 2 cancels, v square into v cube into m by rt, right? Is equal to zero, right? So v cancels, so this becomes v square. 2rt by m is equal to v square, right?
Yeah.
So this is the velocity at which v is equal to root 2rt by m, at which maxima happens. So that is the most probable velocity.
Yeah.
Which is equal to root 2rt by m. Now, average velocity is different. Average velocity you have to take by doing sum of all the velocities, sum of all the v divided by n, right?
Correct.
So this is v average. Now, this is much harder to do. N is total number of particles. Total number of particles will be all the particles in the gas, right? So that will be basically integral of f of v dv, right? From 0 to infinity. It's total number of particles. Because notice that f of v, I was giving you a number of particles. F of v was giving you a number of particles here, right?
Yeah.
F of v was giving you numbers, no? That's why you said most probable was the one with the highest one, right? So if you add up all the f of v's, right? For the entire graph from velocity 0 to infinity, you should get total number of particles, right?
Yeah.
Right. So now, basically, this is this integral of this summation of all the velocities divided by this integral. So the derivation is not in the syllabus. I also don't know right now how it is derived. The answer that comes is root 8 RT by pi m. Okay. This is different from VMP less than V average, and that is less than V RMS. RMS velocity formula came from Boltzmann equipartition theorem. That 3 RT by M we have already seen, root 3 RT by M.
Yeah.
Right? So these are the different velocities. You don't need to worry about the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution function so much, but you just need to know that as temperature increases, right? As temperature increases, more and more particles will start having higher velocities. Right? So suppose this is the curve at some temperature.
as temperature increases, more and more particles will start having higher velocities. This is T2, this is T1. T2 has to be greater than T1. Okay. See, here, when on you are on this curve, you have a higher number of particles with greater velocity, no?
Yeah.
The number is higher, right? More particles have greater velocity here than compared to here, right?
Hmm.
So as temperature increases, more particles have higher velocity. No, now, why have I not drawn it similar to this figure only like this, with this raised up? Like I could have drawn it like this also, like I could have just drawn a peak like this and raised this up, right? Why have I not drawn it like that? Because the graph has to be such that area under this graph is same as the area under the original graph. Because area under this graph was number of particles, no, total. Total number of particles has not changed, no.
Yes.
You understand? Like what I'm saying is, suppose initially it was like this, right? Then true that more number of particles will have higher velocity at a higher temperature. But area under this, right? Area under this should be the same as area under this.
Correct.
Because if the areas are not matching, that means suddenly particles have come from nowhere. That cannot happen. T2 is greater than T1. This is F of V and this is V. Okay.
So yeah.
More particles have higher velocity, but then the peak has to be smaller.
Hmm.
Because peak has to be higher here because a total area must be same. Total area under the curve will be number of particles in the gas.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and fewer particles will have very extreme velocities. Most of the particles will have velocities in some range here, right?
Yeah.
The numbers drop off with the exponentiation graph.
Correct. Yeah.
As T increases, it becomes 1 by e power mv square by 2rt. You know, this is.
Yeah.
As T increases, then this diminishes very fast.
Correct.
So these things you need to know. Other than that, I don't think you need any details here. Then let's go on to 1b2 and understand this collisions and all and kinetic model, collision frequency and those things. Okay, so 1B2 collisions. Okay, so the kinetic model enables us to make the qualitative picture of a gas as a collision, as a collection of moving and colliding molecules. Now, here, what is he saying is, although the kinetic molecular theory assumes that the molecules are point-like, we can count a hit whenever the centers of the two molecules come within a distance d of each other, where d, the collision diameter, is of the order of several of the order of the actual diameters of the molecule. So what is he saying? Suppose this is the actual diameter of the molecule, right? If the particle comes closer to it, close to it, right? Then we count a collision, right? Like if the distance between the centers, right? This distance is, this distance is comparable to D, right? Then we are saying that it is colliding, right? If it is very less than the, if this distance is much more than D, then it is not in collision, right?
Yeah.
So what he is trying to first figure out is what is the collision frequency. So how often do the particles collide? Right? Collision yeah. frequency of a gas, right? So
right. correct.
So obviously collision frequency Z is the number of collisions made by one molecule divided by the time interval during which the collisions are counted, right? So the meaning of that is number of collisions by time interval. By time interval, right?
Yeah.
That is the collision frequency. Then he is saying if there are n molecules in a gas, right? N molecules in a gas, so in a volume V, then Z is collision frequency. Z is collision frequency is equal to sigma V relative into cap N. Sigma V relative into N by V. N by V stands for density of molecules in the gas, right?
Yeah.
Capital N is total number of molecules and volume is V. Total number of molecules. So if there are more total number of molecules, so if there are more molecules in a particular container, then it is more likely that collisions will be higher, right?
Yeah.
So yeah. N by V is logical. V relative is also logical. How fast they are moving around relative to each other decides how many collisions can happen. No?
Yeah.
So these will be proportional to V rel and proportional to this. So this is the constant of proportionality that comes.
Yeah.
Right. Now V rel, V relative, he'll define here. So Z. Okay, so he has actually written area sigma. Sigma is equal to pi d square or collision cross section. So he's saying collision could have happened in a area of pi d square, right? Pi
yeah.
d square. So pi r square. So he's saying, okay, so he's saying d and d 2d, in this area the collision can happen, right?
Yeah.
D plus D in this whole cylinder collision could have happened.
Yeah.
So this 2D. This my D. Pi D square cylinder, right?
Yeah.
Right. This is your D and this is your D. So okay. So sigma is pi D square. V relative is V relative is the relative velocity of these molecules with each other, and N by V is density. So let's just try to understand sigma V relative into N by V, and what will be the value of V relative. So molecules can come towards each other like this with VV, or molecules can go like this. One molecule is going like this, one molecule is going like this, or it could go in the same direction or yeah. same direction like this when no collision happens. So the lowest yeah. V relative could be actually it could be negative also, but negative case we are not going to consider. So think of the speeds here. What is the speed's relative value, right? So this could be 2v, this could be root 2v, right?
Yeah.
Relative velocity will be in this direction.
Correct.
And this could be zero if they are moving in the same direction.
Hmm.
So the values range from 0 to 2v, and if it is a side-on situation like this, the value, intermediate value, is root 2v. So he will assume that V relative for most of the molecules is going to be almost root 2V. That is what he will assume. Root 2V is the, right. because that is an intermediate range.
Correct.
Not all collisions will be head on. Not all collisions will be, there will be no collision. It could be side on type of collision,
right?
Yeah.
So root 2v is going to be the value that he will take and go ahead. Now, one second. There's some justification and all here. Collision frequency. Some typical collision cross sections are given in the table. Sigma is called the collision cross section. In terms of pressure, Z is equal to sigma V rel pressure by KT. Okay, that is obvious. So N by V was there, no? So
yeah,
we already have PV is equal to NRT, right?
Yeah.
So this is equal to PV is equal to N, R is K into Avogadro number into T, and N KMA. So total number of molecules is N into NA is total number of molecules, capital N, right?
Yeah.
Right, because number of moles and Avogadro number, that will be capital N. No?
Yes.
So you can now get N by V will be equal to P by KT, right?
Yeah.
So you can say sigma V rel P by KT, right? So we have Z or collision frequency is proportional to 1 by temperature, right? So if temperature is lower, that doesn't make a lot of sense. One second. N by V is P by KT, yeah? N by V is P by KT, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So maybe, okay, so pressure and temperature are related. So temperature increases, pressure also increases, right? So
yeah. So
both the factors are influential. So let's see what he's saying. Collision frequency according to kinetic model. He has figured out by KT. This is fine. Equation 1B1A, which is the original equation, shows that at constant volume, the collision frequency increases with increasing temperature. So constant volume, collision frequency, okay, correct. So, okay, fine. So we will write down these equations here. Z is equal to sigma V rel N by V, and is also equal to sigma V rel P by KT, right? And sigma is equal to pi D square. V rel is equal to root 2 into V, which is RMS you can take, root 2 into V RMS. And these are the results that we have. Now he is saying first, at constant volume, Z collision frequency is proportional to temperature, because if you fix the V, then N is anyway fixed, then only Z only depends on V rel. No? So if you increase the temperature, velocity of the gas increases, because we have V RMS is equal to root 3 RT by M, right?
Correct.
And V rel is equal to root 2 into V RMS. So it is clearly V rel is proportional to root T, right?
Yeah.
Correct.
So at constant volume, if you have collision frequency increases with increase in temperature, right? Then the second thing that he says is, at constant temperature, collision frequency is proportional to pressure. Okay. At constant temperature. So constant temperature, that means V rel is going to be same, and temperature is constant. So volume is going to be same then, right? No. Okay, let's go to this equation then, right? Yeah, this equation. Constant temperature, V rel is going to be same, T is going to be same, so pressure, direct.
right?
Yeah.
Think of it using this equation. So collision frequency will increase with increasing pressure, right?
Yeah.
Which also makes sense from an intuitive standpoint.
Yeah.
If you have more molecules, then it will be more collisions.
Correct.
Right. So this result is understood. Then although the temperature appears in the equation in a sample in equation 1.B.13, which is, oh, okay. That is after mean free path. So let's go to mean free path. So what is the mean free path? Once we have collision frequency, we can calculate the mean free path lambda, or average distance a molecule travels between collisions, right? Mean free path means how much distance will a molecule travel between two collisions. Distance traveled between two collisions. So this value can be gotten by V relative into collision, 1 by collision frequency. No? Collision frequency is number of collisions per unit time, right?
Yeah.
So between any two collisions, the time interval will be 1 by Z, right?
Yes.
Correct. 1 second divided by Z.
Frequency.
Time for one collision, the time between one collision.
Yeah.
So multiply that by V relative, right? That should give you the lambda, right?
Yes.
That should give you the distance that it will travel.
Yeah.
Correct. So you will get V relative by Z. So V relative by Z is coming out to be, in this equation, V relative by Z is coming out to be sig, V by sigma N, right?
Yeah.
V relative by Z is V by sigma N is equal to lambda, right?
So yeah.
Sigma is pi d square, no? And volume, so lambda is proportional to V by N, right? So, okay. Or you could also use this equation, V relative by Z. So in this equation, it becomes KT by rho sigma P, right?
Yeah.
Lambda is equal to KT by sigma P, right?
Correct.
So if you have, now if temperature is increased, pressure also increases, so it remains same.
Yeah.
Right? Because temperature and pressure are directly proportional, no?
Yeah.
So.
Correct.
So. He says here, doubling the pressure reduces the mean free path by half. I mean, as long as you keep the temperature same. If you keep one of these two things same, right? And change one thing, then obviously mean free path will change. Right? But if you don't do that, although the temperature appears in the equation in a sample of gas at constant volume, the pressure is proportional to T. So T by P remains constant when temperature is increased, right?
Yeah.
Therefore, right. Mean free path is independent of the temperature in a sample of gas in a container of fixed volume. So basically, if you have a container of gas with fixed volume, the mean free path, how much time it travels before a collision, is independent of temperature, because lambda is equal to some constants into T by P.
Yes.
So if you increase the temperature, pressure also increases. So this ratio remains same. So no matter how some gas might have low temperature and gas molecules are moving slowly, then they will cover only a small distance. But if you have a high temperature and you're moving fast, you will also collide much faster. So you'll still cover the same amount of distance before encountering another collision.
Correct. So that is the meaning here. So mean free path collision frequency we have done, then this 1B is over. So, okay. 1B is done. Then we come to 1C. 1C is real gases. This 1C has basically the gas corrections and the different behavior of real gases from ideal gas. We had seen earlier that it is P plus A N square by V square V minus NB is equal to NRT. This was our van der Waals equation.
Yes.
Real gas equation. Right? That is one real gas equation. There are other candidate equations also. So we will try to understand what he is saying here. So there are deviations from ideal gas behavior because of two reasons. One reason is that volume is not negligible. And the other reason is that intermolecular forces are there. The other reason is intermolecular forces are present. Right? These are the two reasons. Now, here, if we go down here, the first thing that we will see is what is the meaning of this compression factor? Okay, so we will introduce a new term called compression factor. Now, this compression factor Z is defined as the ratio of measured molar volume of a gas to the molar volume of a perfect gas at the same temperature and pressure. Measured molar volume of a gas divided by molar volume of ideal gas at the same T and P. So basically, it is like saying whatever is the molar volume right now at some particular condition currently divided by the volume, molar volume that comes if it was an ideal gas, right? This is an experimental measurement, right? At the same T and P.
Yeah.
Now, if it is one, if Z is equal to one, then the gas is behaving like an ideal gas. If it is not behaving like an ideal gas, the ratio will not be one, right?
Yeah.
So if the ratio is greater than one, then which type of forces are dominant? Repulsive forces?
Yes.
If the ratio is less than one, then attractive forces are dominant. Right?
Right.
So this is an experimental measurement that has come. Now let's go to the book. So we write this as PVM is equal to Z into, okay. So we will write VM is equal to Z into VM this. And if you multiply it by the pressure, and here also pressure, now we know that ideal gas PVM dash will be equal to Z into R into T, right? NRT, right?
Yeah.
Correct. And correct. If it was measured for one mole, I think, molar volume, so N is one. So let's say ZRT, right? So PVM is equal to ZRT comes. Right?
Yeah.
Because PVM, VM this dot means RT, right? This is an ideal gas.
Yeah.
Right? So T and T were anyway fixed by the experiment that you are doing. So we get, this is the measurable, this is the measurement value that you want to find out. This is the actual molar volume for the real gas, right?
Yeah.
And T and T are the conditions
R is the gas constant and Z is the compressibility. So Z is defined now as PVM by RT. Right?
Yes.
Okay. So there are some graphs here, some experimental values are shown. You can read up this section. Now, virial coefficients. So now what happens is we can relate Z to the basically we are going to relate Z to the experimental measurements. Hello?
What? Yeah.
So experimentally you can draw curves of PV graph and find out the actual values of the V and the P, right? And Z is equal to PVM by RT, this expression, now you will connect it using an equation. What is this equation? look at the third one, 1C.3B. So the equation is saying PVM is equal to RT 1 plus B by VM, RT 1 plus B by VM plus C by VM square and so on. Okay. Now, what is the meaning of this? What is he saying? He's saying that any deviations from Z is equal to 1. Z is equal to 1 means ideal gas, right?
Hmm.
He's trying to capture what is the deviation of a real gas from this one value. There might be some difference between a real gas value of Z and ideal gas value, no? So if you write like this, then what is coming? PVM by RT is equal to 1 plus B by VM plus C by VM square plus so on, right?
Yeah.
So basically what you're getting is Z is equal to 1 plus B by VM plus C by VM square and so on. So
yeah.
These portions are telling you how much is the deviation from ideal gas behavior, right? Normally, if it is a perfect gas, Z is equal to 1. If it is not, it will have some changes. So some deviations, positive or negative. So the coefficients B and C are called virial coefficients, which are deciding whether it is which type of force is dominant, whether it is an attractive force that is dominant or a repulsive force that is dominant. If B and C have positive signs, then repulsive forces are dominant because of which Z is greater than 1, right? If B and C have negative signs or something, then basically that means attractive forces are dominant, right?
Yeah.
So basically you are measuring the deviation of an real gas from an ideal gas behavior by measuring the values of the compressibility. Compressibility is Z is equal to PVM by RT. VM is the actual measured molar volume of a real gas. And P and RT are the temperatures and all at that moment. Right?
Yeah.
If Z came out as 1, then the answer is it is behaving as an ideal gas. If Z did not come out as 1, it could be, according to this equation, it could deviate. Right?
Yeah.
And that is basically Z is equal to 1 plus this. Right? Now these B and C are called the virial coefficients, which decide which type of force is dominant in the particular gas.
Yeah.
Whether it is attractive force dominant or repulsive force dominant. So the first virial coefficient is, so some table is given. One second. The coefficients B and C, which depend on the temperature, are the second and third virial coefficients, table 1.C.1. The first virial coefficient is 1. Yeah, B and C are second and third. First one is 1. The third virial coefficient C is usually less important than the second one, in the sense that at typical molar volume, C by VM square is much smaller than B by VM. So what mostly matters is the value of B. Okay.
Yeah.
Mostly matters is the value of B. C by Vm square tends to be too small. So that's fine. An important point is that although the equation of state of a real gas may coincide with the perfect gas value, perfect gas law, as P tends to zero, not all its properties coincide with those of a perfect gas in that limit. So at low pressure, right? At low pressure and temperature, at low pressure, what happens? Vm is large, no?
Yeah.
So we have Z is equal to P Vm by RT is equal to 1 plus B by Vm plus C by Vm square and so on, right? So in the limit of pressure being small, P tending to zero, right? Low pressure.
Yeah.
Real gases will also behave like ideal gases because Z will be tending to one. Because low pressure means Vm is large. So B by Vm will be small and C by Vm square will be tending to zero and all. No?
Yeah.
So at the ideal gas, even a real gas will tend to an ideal gas behavior as pressure is lowered, right?
Yeah.
Right? But however, all properties of the real gas may not be the same as an ideal gas, even if pressure is low. Because what happens is this is, say, Z is equal to one line. This is the value of the real gas Z, right?
Mm.
And it could be something like this also. It will tend to one as P tends to zero, but it has a slope, right? It has a slope, and this also has a slope, right? For this graph, slope is also always zero, right? Slope is always zero.
Yeah.
Right? And for this graph, slope is not always zero. And some properties of ideal gases depend not just on compressibility, but also the slope on all of this graph. Some property will, even in the limiting case, some properties will be different from real gas. It is not like from ideal gas. It is not like just because compressibility has become tending to one, that doesn't mean that it is perfectly exactly same as the ideal gas. Some properties could depend on the way it is approaching that ideal gas curve, no? So that is what he's saying, that not everything is identical. So for a perfect gas, dz by dp is zero because z is equal to one at all pressures. For an ideal gas, dz by dp is equal to zero as z is equal to one at all pressures, right?
Yeah.
But for a real gas, dz by dp could be positive or negative at some other pressure, right?
Yeah.
So therefore, not everything is going to be same. So what is he saying here? Let's do dz by dp, right? If you have your equation z is equal to 1 plus b by vm plus c by vm square and so on, right?
Yeah.
You could have written this equation in the pressure form also by replacing vm with rt by p and all.
Yeah.
P vm is equal to rt, right? So vm is equal to rt by p. So you could have written it as 1 plus b by rt by p plus c by rt square p square and so on, right?
Yes.
Now dz by dp is equal to b by rt plus c by rt square into 2p and so on, right? So as p tends to zero, dz by dp tends to, this vanishes, b by rt, right?
Yeah.
Not zero, right?
Yeah.
But dz by dp for an ideal gas is always zero.
Yeah. always, no?
So there is a slight difference. dz by dp is not zero for this gas, right?
Correct.
So however, b dash is not, okay, slope of z does not necessarily approach zero, right? By a similar argument, because several physical properties of gases depend on derivatives, properties of real gases do not always coincide with the perfect gas values at low pressure. Okay, so same thing, because the virial coefficients, these virial coefficients means the values of this B and C, they depend on temperature. They depend on temperature. So he's saying there may be a temperature at which Z tends to one with zero slope at low pressure or high molar volume. So at this temperature, which is called Boyle's temperature, the properties of real gas do coincide with those of perfect gas. So what is he saying? Z has zero slope as P tends to zero if B is equal to zero. dz by d of 1 by Vm. So, one second. Okay. So if B is zero, right? Then dz by dp also tends to zero. Right?
Yeah.
If B is zero, right? So when is B zero? When is B zero is what he's trying to find. And at a particular temperature, at a particular temperature, which is called Boyle's temperature, you will have properties of the real gas will coincide with the properties of an ideal gas perfectly. So what is that temperature? How will you find Boyle's temperature? One second. Okay, I think it is an experimental thing. I don't think you can derive it. Like, we have B and C depend on temperature. Okay. And there could be a T value at which B disappears. No?
Yeah.
You understand what is happening?
So yeah.
If there is a temperature value at which B disappears, right? That temperature value is called Boyle's temperature, which is found by experiment. Boyle's temperature is the temperature value at which B disappears. Okay. So then what will happen is that the slope also tends to zero. Right? Yeah. dz by dp is also tending to zero. Then, right?
Yeah.
And if dz by dp tends to zero, then it is behaving perfectly like an ideal gas.
Yeah.
Right? So Boyle's temperature is the temperature at which the gas will behave perfectly like an ideal gas. Now, here in the book, he has written that for helium, TB is equal to 22.64 Kelvin. For air, it is 346.8 Kelvin. And more values are given in a table. The Boyle's temperature value. Okay. So basically, Boyle temperature values are the values for which the B coefficient tends to zero as pressure is reduced. So what is the definition? Boyle's temperature is T such that B tends to zero as pressure tends to zero. And what is B? B is Z is equal to 1 plus B by Vm plus C by Vm square and so on. And this is B, right? And Z is equal to PVM by RT.
Yeah.
Right? So Z is compressibility, right?
And normally, Z tends to 1 as P tends to 0. But dz by dp tends to b by r something we got, b by rt or something, as p tends to 0. Right?
Yeah.
Whereas for an ideal gas, this tends to 0. So what we have left now is this critical temperature, critical volume, critical constants of a gas, and van der Waals equation, a little more stuff is left. So 3-4 pages are there, but like there is, no, actually 5-6 pages are. Principle of corresponding states, still there we have to read, but I want you guys to try some questions from here, okay? This will be slightly tougher, but try some of these exercise questions because they are quite thought-provoking. Okay. This will be much more advanced than what you have done so far. So topics 1B and 1A, you can definitely attempt questions from. So if you look at the exercise, there is topic 1A, there are some exercises, right? Then there are some exercises from topic 1B, kinetic model. Okay. And finally, there are some exercises from real gases. Okay. So you can try the exercise questions and also the problems also. As many as you can, just try as many as you can, see if you are getting an understanding what is happening. 1A and 1B, you can definitely try some questions, exercise questions at least. And one more class I think is necessary, one class for the van der Waals stuff and the critical constants and stuff. Also, you have to send me a message with the new times and all and whatever you want.
I'll send it by today.
So just let me know what are the new schedules that you prefer.
We'll just discuss it and I'll tell you.
Yeah. Okay. That's it for now then.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Okay. Bye.